I want to just take 1 minute to go back into the Old Testament and some words of Scofield himself to show you how clearly it is that Scofield was influenced and that he actually had someone doing the ghostwriting for him and putting down things on those yellow pads that Scofield himself could probably have never dreamed of. We're looking here at the notes to the Scofield Reference Bible, the original one written in 1909. This is Deuteronomy 30. Verses 3 through 5. And I want to read to you the note that is written about this verse. Now, first let me tell you what the verse is really all about. This section of Deuteronomy talks about a covenant, and it talks about the ancient Israelites being shown the land that God had promised to them. And this is covered in some detail in Deuteronomy 30. But Cyrus Scofield placed this note, or that someone placed this note in this 1909 Scofield Bible, and I think it shows that someone was already writing about Palestine 30 years before there was a state of Palestine, 40 years before there was a state of Palestine, and before the word would have even meant anything to Scofield. Here's what the note said. The Palestinian covenant gives the conditions under which Israel entered the land of promise. It is important to see that the nation was never as of yet taken the land under the unconditional Abrahamic covenant, nor has it ever possessed the whole land. So what this footnote is telling us is that when the people of Abraham were shown the land and went in and occupied the land, this footnote by Scofield is saying they really never got the land, that that promise is still outstanding there. The nation of Israel never did receive the land. It's very unusual to talk about the nation of Israel in the Old Testament because, of course, Israel was a man and those who followed him were simply a tribe. And boundaries were not something they really did talk about. But you can see that someone here in 1909 already knew there was going to be a Palestine, that there was going to be land taken in Palestine, that it was going to be occupied, and that there was going to be an excuse needed for taking and using that land. And whoever knew that wrote this footnote to the book of Deuteronomy that referred to a covenant that's not even mentioned. The word Palestine is not even mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy. Nowhere is it mentioned in the Old Testament. The book Palestine is not even mentioned. The word Philistine is mentioned some places, but Scofield actually used the modern word Palestine in this note, and it clearly to me shows that someone else was ghostwriting his notes and was preparing for a state of Israel in 1909 when the state of Israel was not even created until 1948, 39 years later. Now, I've said that there was a powerful influence carried out to market the Scofield Study Bible. Mr. Scofield commented in his biography how amazed he was at his success, how incredibly surprised he was at how much money he got in royalties on his Bible. Of course, that money paid to him by Oxford University Press, who we now know owned the Bible from the very get-go. And the reason we know that is when Scofield died, Oxford Press went right ahead editing the Bible and appointing new people to its editorial staff and making the changes they wanted to make in their own name. And Scofield's family had nothing to do with it, even though one of his friend's grandson is on the editorial board today, and there's an effort made to keep the names consistent. Nevertheless, it appears that there was very little control. Now, here in the 1967 edition of the Bible, you see that Cyrus I. Scofield is still listed as the editor of the Bible. And that doesn't show in this page, which is truncated. We have to look at one of the other pages to see that, because this has been cut off. But what we intend to show in this slide is that there are four theologians who are heads of seminary on this editorial committee of the new edition in 1967. Those include John F. Walvoord, head of the powerful Dallas Theological Seminary, the most prominent theological seminary in evangelical circles today. And Walvoord was the president of that, and we believe he promoted the Scofield Study Bible to everyone who attended that seminary from that day forward. And here is the Dallas Theological Seminary. It was founded in 1924, and a good part of its success is probably owed to the fact that it has been closely allied with the Scofield people ever since. Today, it's probably the most prominent seminary in evangelical circles, and many of the most prominent evangelicals attended there, including Hal Lindsey, author of The Late Great Planet Earth, and someone who is truly committed to the idea of Armageddon. It's necessary for us to talk in practical terms about what can be done about this dilemma. What we have is a problem, as we started off discussing, where de Tocqueville stated that America's greatness lay in her churches, in the righteousness of those who attended them, and the ideas that were brought forth by the churches of the 19th century. And I'm not saying that the churches were perfect in the 19th century. There was a very great weakening toward the turn of the 20th century, as the Civil War was a very destructive, and war is always destructive to order and religion and morality, and the Civil War was one of the great destroyers of morality. The Evangelical Church probably had noble enough beginning. People that started these Southern Baptist Convention, other churches, probably had ideas about reforming the tottering and drifting mainline churches of the late 19th century, the turn of the century. But nevertheless, the movement was very quickly captured, and as Dr. F. Furman Curley, a professor of Bible and director of graduate studies at Abilene Christian University, said in 1985 in his remarkable book, The Middle East Crisis in Biblical Perspective, Christians must pray for peace in the Middle East. Premillennialists, and this means followers of Scofield, must pray and work for World War III, or as we have put that, the war against Islam, so Armageddon will come. They cannot pray for peace, because they want an Armageddon, and that Armageddon has to take place in Israel. And Israel is the place where the Palestinians and the Palestinian conflict takes place, and it is the center of the war issue in the Middle East. We have today somewhere between 40 and 100 million evangelicals in America. We have a president who calls himself an evangelical, a born-again Christian. For my own history, I am a former Southern Baptist deacon, and I'm very, very familiar with what goes on in evangelical churches. And I followed those ideas myself until I realized that the evangelical church was supporting war. It was supporting any war in the Middle East. The evangelical church wasn't necessarily for war in Korea. It wasn't necessarily for war in Vietnam, though there was a tendency to be very supportive of the business administrations. But it was absolutely in support of the first Gulf War, the upcoming war in Sudan, and other wars that have taken other police occupations and devastations that have taken place in other countries. And so we need to examine what can be done to change this. And in our organization, we hold these truths. We started a project called Project Straight Gate. Now we'll talk about what can be done about this problem. Judaized Christians enable war is the topic of one of our articles. We could have said Christian Zionists enable war as well, a more popular word at the present moment. We're talking about the very churches where John Hagee, Rod Parsley, John MacArthur, and thousands of prominent evangelicals teach. This is a picture of Project Straight Gate Vigil being held in front of John MacArthur's Grace Community Church in Sun Valley, California. Note the sign, "Blessed are the peacemakers." For some strange reason, this sign incenses some evangelical Christians, even though it is a direct quote from Jesus. John MacArthur has appeared on the Larry King Live show a number of times and has been invited to the White House. He has blessed the Gulf War, and he stands behind the police action in Palestine. Here is another vigil being conducted at Calvary Chapel in Costa Mesa, California. It's pastored by the well-known Chuck Smith. Calvary Chapel has spawned the growth of over 25 other Calvary Chapels around California and the West. Here is a picture of another vigil, which we have come to call interventions, at the Calvary Chapel in Tempe, Arizona. At this Calvary Community Church in Phoenix, Arizona, the church members were so agitated by the presence of Project Straight Gate's vigil that they hoisted the Israeli flag, as you see. These two ladies are standing in front of the Southern Baptist Convention, a very large convention of pastors who gathered in Phoenix, Arizona in 2002, just before the start of the bombing of Iraq. They were there holding pictures of Palestinian children and Palestinian families who'd been bulldozed, and they were there to talk to the pastors. Project Straight Gate has conducted something like 50 of these vigils at mainline churches, evangelical churches, and major conventions of churches all over the country. This vigil is being held in front of the largest Baptist church in Bakersfield, California. The pastor of this church came out and talked to us twice. You see the signs, "Choose Life, Not War," Project Straight Gate with a phone number, "No More Wars for Israel." It has a cross with Palestine on the crossbar, a crucifixion of Palestine. And at this church, we had a very good reception, and we had a number of people came out and talked to us, and a number of them tried very hard to change what we believe, too. Here we have a counter demonstration. These people came out. Evangelicals react to vigil at their church. These people were in the church. They went inside, made their own signs, came out on the street, and started picketing. It was just before the election. They misunderstood our intentions. They thought we were campaigning for John Kerry. We don't campaign for presidential candidates. and certainly didn't campaign for John Kerry. And they're carrying George Bush Cheney signs that they have glued onto their hastily made signs. And these signs read, "Don't listen to these radicals," and "We support our president," and things like that. And they came out and stood on the curbs, held a counter demonstration to our demonstration. Our purpose, of course, is to raise the question of what would Jesus say about bombing the children of Iraq? What would Jesus say about bombing the children of Palestine? What would Jesus say about destroying Jaber's school in Gaza, where his children go? Now you're looking at one of the most famous churches in America. It's Thomas Rowe Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia. The man on your right is Jerry Falwell. This is his home church. It holds many hundreds of people. I don't know how many people it holds. And this is our vigil 2 years ago at Thomas Rowe Baptist Church. We came back to Lynchburg, Virginia when Jerry Falwell held a pastor's conference there. And that pastor's conference drew literally thousands of pastors. I think there were supposed to have been 7,000 participants, many of them pastors. And we talked to pastors all afternoon long and to students at the university. It was held at Liberty University in Lynchburg. This is one of the wonderful success feelings that we had, was talking to the people coming in and out of the door. And we were able to stand right next to the pillars there, even on the steps of this church, and talk to the people with it at range of 10 or 15 feet as they came and went into this church by the hundreds. It was a great experience in front of this church. Now, what is this all about, ladies and gentlemen? I'm showing you a picture of the entrance, the gate, that you have to go through in order to get into the Gaza Strip. This is called Eris Gate. This is looking back after one is safely inside the Gaza Strip. A prison with walls all around it and fences, a place that you cannot leave, and a place where nothing can get in unless the State of Israel decides they want to let it in. The starvation occurs at their will inside these fences, and there's no escaping the Gaza Strip. That gate you see in front of you is empty. There's no one coming in. If you look back, there's not a single person in view, and the soldiers are hidden behind the barricades back there, the Israeli soldiers. This is a wide corridor. It's about 100 yards wide. And the fences are very tall. They have razor wire on top of them. There's no getting in, and there's no getting out. This is where America is heading. We're heading for a gulag in which those who do not cooperate will find that there's no getting in, and there's no getting out. It may be a literal gulag. It may be an intellectual gulag. But it's time that we act, and it's necessary that we take our part right now to defend the people around the world who are being bombed and killed. In order to do this, we need to take action. And our idea of this is to go directly to America's churches. In the last election, the one that reelected George W. Bush, he gained some 80% of the evangelical Christian vote. Had it not been for the evangelical Christian vote, there would have been a mandate against war in America. We're not saying we would have had a good president. We're only saying that there would have been a mandate against war. The way it is, we now have a mandate for war. I want to tell you that we do not use the term war except in quotation marks. When I say that word, I mean that stands for someone else's word. That's the word of the people who are selling us the war, quote, war. Because we are not engaged in wars, we are engaged in killing operations in which we pen up people. Just like the people inside the Gaza Strip, we pen up people in places like Fallujah and Baghdad, and we annihilate all that we need to in order to get our way in those countries. There is no resistance to the American government today. There is no one capable of fighting back. There is no one capable of standing against them. There is only us from within who protect the rights of the people of the world.